I call this meeting to order. It's Tuesday, March 21st, regular meeting, which was moved from the snow day last Tuesday. So roll call, all councilors are present except Councilor Watson and Councilor Perizzati. I know Councilor Watson. I know, right? No deodorant today. Councilor Watson said we knew he wouldn't be here. I think Councilor Perizzati, I would imagine she's running late. Does anybody have any calendar communications?
I do.
Go ahead.
I met with town manager and ACO and city mayor on the sub-base dock on the 20th. And it appears that the base CO is going to take action on
great.
On the permitting and applying for the grant, but the base is going to do the contract work.
Great.
So yeah, it's moving forward.
That all you got?
Yeah.
Anybody else?
Oh, and I went to the meeting last night, the state rep and the Senator Summers on the PCS cuts.
Yep.
Yeah, along with you.
Yep.
It was quite informative.
Karen?
I just wanted to let the council know that I attended the swearing-in ceremony last Wednesday here at the Annex for the two newest promotees for the town police department. They promoted a new sergeant and a new lieutenant. And so I represented the council and the mayor in that.
Thank you very much, Karen. Great. Anybody like, can somebody move? Oh, there's no minutes to move. Any unfinished business?
On the revised agenda, you can
move. Oh, we do. I'm sorry. I'm going off hold. Would somebody like to move the minutes?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? That passes 7-0. And is there any unfinished business? And we'll move on to new business. First item, 2017-0042, the zoning regulations rewrite update, is a joint meeting with the Zoning Commission, and that's gonna go off at 6:00. So we're gonna try to get some business done before we have that meeting at 6:00. The next item on the agenda is 2017-0025, the Small Cities Community Development Block Grant 2017 application.
At your last town council meeting on the 7th, you held a public hearing. Staff was here, gave you a presentation as to the contents of this application, which is to provide funding for rehabilitation work associated with Mystic River Homes. Very fine presentation was made. There were no public comments received, and you closed the public hearing after that. Purpose of having this item on the agenda is to determine if you wish us to proceed with submitting the application to DECD.
Thank you. Is there any?
And John is here. And Paige.
Hi, Paige. Does anybody have any questions? Anybody? You guys have anything you'd like to say without lack of question?
I think we conducted the hearing and we provided details regarding the request. We're again seeking authority to move forward with our application for $800,000. And as you know, at the public hearing, there were no additional comments. We've been fairly fortunate and successful recently, and we're hoping with the council's support that we're able to secure more funding.
Okay, great.
I'll make the motion to authorize the town manager to apply for the CDBG funds on behalf of Mystic River Funds.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilor Grimm, a second by Councilor Nall. Is there any other discussion? Yes, Councilor Nall.
This is slightly off topic, but it's related. And when was the last time that we saw, when I think of CDBG, I think of our low-income housing.
Right.
Okay. I call it low-income housing, there are other qualifiers as well. And I know that we have a whole body to deal with that. When was the last time that we saw sort of an an accounting, income expense, balance sheet sort of thing. I mention that because I had been asked by a couple of people, you know, when was the last time you folks ever saw the numbers for, you know, for our housing, what's spent on what? And I can't remember offhand when we saw an accounting. I think we have, but I can't remember the last time. It may have been a while, so. It's more of a request than a question.
If I could, I mean, our program now is very different than it used to be in that years ago, we actually had staff, you know, we had paid staff that worked on the community development block grant program full-time, and it could have been a building inspector, a spec writer, a coordinator, and so forth. We've kind of shifted away from that in that while we still do, on occasion, rehab work of single-family homes and other structures, a lot of that work, besides oversight by Paige and Sue Cullen and John, a lot of that work is being done through a contract we have with ECHO. And there, so there, there really aren't those types of expenses that we used to have. I mean, it is broken out in the town budget in terms of community development activities and so forth. But as part of your audit, the program is audited on an annual basis. As you, it's probably one of those attachments, not the main audit, but one of the smaller attachments that you get in January does talk about all grants, including the community development block grant. And, but I'm not sure, Dean, that's what you're necessarily looking for. Is there?
No, I think the question ultimately is who has oversight, and do they? And a lot of people assume, well, you're the town council, so everything is within your purview. Not exactly. But I do remember seeing statements that relate to that, to those functions. So just curious as to whether or not we can expect anything from anybody else. Yeah.
I just wanted to add to that. I think what was mentioned by Mark, the town manager, is certainly true. In addition, we are reviewed annually by the state, by the Department of Housing. And sometimes it's a more extensive review, other times it's less. And this year they'll actually be coming down by summertime, I believe, and going through all of our files. And their audit is more than just financial, it deals with organizational structure. So they want to make sure that we're doing things in accordance with state and federal law and procedures. So they also have significant oversight regarding how we're performing, in addition to the fiduciary responsibilities that the town has with our auditor.
So if people wanted to, if people had questions about the expenditure of, you know, where the rent goes, whatever's paid, where the subsidies go, et cetera, what's spent, who would they contact? Who would be the point person for that?
They could start with me.
Okay.
I don't believe all of our information is public record, though, given that it involves some personal finances.
Well, certainly, yes. Right. Yeah. That part I understand, but I think people, there might be people curious about the overall operation. Thank you.
Sure.
Don't belabor it. Thank you.
Dinner delivery. Sorry. We have a. We had a motion, right? And a
yes.
Second.
Yes, sorry.
Is there any other discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Sorry. I just have a question. How much is that contract that we have with ECHO?
I don't remember the dollar.
Like ballpark.
I'm sorry, can you repeat?
Ballpark, how much is the contract with ECHO?
Well, to prepare the application is roughly $5,000. Which is reimbursable by the program. And I believe that might be the majority of our expense. Oftentimes, the entity that is the final beneficiary of the funding, in the past we've had the Housing Authority, they'll actually pay out of their match the costs for ECHO to do a lot of the project oversight in the field and handling a lot of the reports.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? That passes 7-0. Thank you. Next is 2017-0069, request for letter of support for Thames River Innovation Place. And,
Anna's here.
What's that?
Anna's here.
Hi, Ann. Hi.
Good evening.
Hi, Hannah.
And, nice to see you, and nice to see everyone. My name is Hannah Gant, and I am associated with Spark Makerspace, which is a community-run workshop and learning center that I've helped to get started in the last couple of years in downtown New London. Many Groton residents from southeastern Connecticut coming together to access shared workspaces to be able to work on projects, learn, make, do, connect, collaborate, very much kind of a center for people to create economic opportunity for themselves. And Spark is part of the Connecticut Next Partner Network. So CT Next is a program that's under the Department of Economic and Community Development and Connecticut Innovations. Last year, CT Next was made kind of its own kind of quasi-independent entity, and the state gave it $30 million for the next 5 years to create and administrate a new program that they're calling Innovation Places. And so because of Spark's association pre-existing with CT Next, I was aware of that opportunity and brought it to the City of New London, to the City of Groton, Town of Groton, and have been partnering with the Cure Innovation Commons, which is a science and technology incubator that started in Groton last year, and many other actors to spearhead an effort to get New London and Groton as the Thames River Innovation Place designated by the state with the opportunity to kind of compete for up to $5 million a year for the next 5 years. And so you may be aware that the town of Groton supported the planning effort. I've been working very closely with Paige Bronk and Sam Eisenbeiser initially put together an application for the planning grant, which we achieved in September of last year, and that that was an effort of raising about $30,000 locally to match what the state then gave us, $50,000 to support a planning phase to write kind of a master plan for kind of innovation and how we're going to support innovation and collaboration to really leverage all of the resources that we have here to make this a really viable and attractive place for current and future residents to live, work, play, start businesses, and create value in multiple ways. And so that application is due next Saturday, April 1st, and it is a requirement of that grant that we have a letter of support from all of the municipalities that are participating. And so the City of New London has written that letter. I presented at Council for City of Groton last night, and am pleased to be here today formally making that request and to share an update and answer any questions that the Council may have about the Thames River Innovation Place initiative.
Bonnie?
I've attended several of the events, and it's a great opportunity to not only work with New London and the city, but the real goal is to get funding for jobs in this area. So I think we should wholeheartedly support it.
Rich?
What is Groton's financial responsibility?
Well, at this time, we were moving forward, there's no firm commitment of an ongoing financial responsibility. It was wonderful in the planning phase to demonstrate that support. The amount of human resources that has gone in through the planning phase in terms of, say, Sam and Paige's presence has been helpful and significant. And it's really going to be, I think that is more of the type of support that we're looking for at this time.
I think it's more in-kind support, as Hannah mentioned, but I want to emphasize that we're looking for support to move into the next phase. It's an implementation phase. So I think there was a question at the time when we requested the $5,000, will this money be put to good use? It certainly has. Not all of the submittals were granted awards. So we were successful in getting planning funds from the state, as Hannah said, $50,000. So now we vie for the big money. And I believe the in-kind support ongoing from Groton and our other partners actually will put us in a strong position to, we're actually competing for hundreds of thousands now. So we're moving up the ladder. And we have the plan, we have the application with multiple partners, and we have projects that we're submitting. And this is somewhat exponentially growing. More momentum, more people, more resources are being allocated to it. So although it's short money to have in-kind services from the town, it actually is leading to many other partners and other resources coming to the table.
And, you know, I would also add, this being kind of moving into the implementation phase, part of what we've identified in the planning phase are concrete projects that actually have return on investment and are attractive for the private sector. And so moving forward, I don't really expect a lot of financial responsibility from the municipalities. We've done a lot of groundwork and are now initiating a process that's making it much more hospitable for private money to come in and support the work that's gonna be happening.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. It's all along the river is the focus of this thing. So they're engaging the oyster farmers, and there's been presentations that there's all sorts of people who are participating at no cost. They're volunteering their time. So it's a pretty low budget but high return project.
Dean?
Out of curiosity, I mean, thinking it's easy to always bet on the sure thing. It's when you're being asked to invest time or money into the less sure things where you see a lot of people backing off. And so I'm always in favor of efforts to support the less sure things. You know, this is a 1 in 10 kind of a thing. So I've had some little experience with private incubation spaces where the rents are super low, the landlord is fairly indulgent. If you can't make your rent this month, the whole purpose is, here's your space, see what you could do with it. What experience do you have with differentiating between people who are giving it the college try and people who are really not going anywhere? People are taking advantage of the resources of the program, either physical space or some other resources that are, for lack of a better term, I hate to use this because I can't think of one at the moment, is freeloading. How often do you get that? I don't know if I'm making any sense.
Yeah, no, I hear your question, and it sounds like a question that's specific maybe to the experience that I'm having starting Spark Makerspace.
Right.
Yeah, and I don't really want to go into too much detail with respect to Spark because, Spark is kind of like maybe a candidate for support through this program. But I'd rather lift up other projects that we're identifying that are more directly in kind of the wheelhouse of the town of Groton, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, one of those is the what we're calling the community concierge. And another that I would think I would let Paige speak to more is the Underwater Sea Institute. And we're also looking at supporting pre-development planning and analysis feasibility studies for underdeveloped commercial areas like Thames Street and what could be happening in downtown Groton. So we're really looking broadly at a number of investments and projects that would really make this place more viable, as I said, for people to wanna live here, stay here, start businesses, And so Community Concierge is a program that we've been working with major employers like Electric Boat, Pfizer, L&M, Yale Hospital, to learn about how they recruit and what are some things that could be happening to help retain. So, you know, for example, when, you know, EB hires someone, they get, that person moves here and has 2 weeks at a hotel and 2 weeks with a rental car, no other support. And so, and nothing really to support, you know, a spouse that may be moving with them. And so the Community Concierge is a program that's actually going to create a more kind of like robust invitation, welcoming wagon, so to speak, of a dedicated kind of like some community ambassadors. When you move here, you meet with these people. They've got access to kind of a technology platform that can help connect those people who are moving here with, you know, communities, new friends, where the places you might like to go eat, you know, places of worship, cultural historical sites that they might see, so that we can like really quickly start to embed people in the social fabric of our community. And that's going to be a service that actually many current residents will also benefit from. So some of this is being through kind of like, we're entering implementation phase, but the state has also made clear that they know that they've given us a very short timeline to come up with a number of ideas. And so some of the next step is actually moving through concept into design and implementation. So there's still some fleshing out of the details that has to happen with these programs, but that's one that everybody has been in agreement is needed, and the state likes that idea. We've already been in communication with them about that. So the Underwater Sea Institute, I think, is another example that Paige can speak to better than I can.
Just a couple points. It's important to realize this is regional. John and I were in Hartford today at the Governor's Economic Summit, and they continue to stress moving forward. They're looking for different paradigms. I know we're moving through our budget process, and the economy is everything people are focusing on, and we believe are being competitive on a regional level in working with all of our partners. Regarding the concierge project, I just want to add, EB has spoken with us saying they're really concerned about how they not only attract employees but retain. Worst case scenario is a new employee comes with their family and they don't assimilate. They're not comfortable. And after 6 months of training, they leave. It's a worst case scenario. We're talking about thousands of people that are anticipated to come to this region. So the concierge is about trying to help families and workers feel comfortable to the area before they even get here. So that's critical, not only to Groton, but to the region. Regarding the undersea consortium, we've been in touch with UConn, been in conversations even before we started this project, but their concept deals with a supply chain network, similar to what exists in the state with aeronautics. And we do have the benefit of being on the coast. We're situated in a great location. We have EB here, but we also have R&D for Coast Guard located in New London. What we propose in partnership with UConn is to have an institute. Part of that institute would include this consortium where you build a network of supply chain providers, not only to EB, but to other maritime industries in the area. And it's possible that there be additional coordination with maybe even some out of state. UConn has discussed maybe coordinating with URI. I think many of you have heard we have a business that's coming to town shortly. They'll be on Leonard Drive, Thayer Mahan, or Mahan, and they'll start with 10 employees, moving up to 50. They focus on underwater, unmanned vehicles and devices that actually will track foreign submarines. So that's another example of a network, an underwater network. We want to be a hub of it. that's a part of that project. We're envisioning that that would be located at Avery Point. That is where UConn out of stores would like it to be located as well. So these are the types of projects that have local bearing, but they also have significance to us regionally.
Thank you.
One last thing. My question was fabulously ignorant and inapropos in a lot of ways, but thank you, because it obviously provided you with an opportunity to expound. So thank you for the information. Sorry for the question.
Yeah, that's no problem. You know, and I think I'd also like to just reel back and provide a little bit more context in terms of kind of the strategic plan and some goals that really emerged for us during this planning phase. And we really kind of have three overarching goals that we've identified. And one is to really help inspire and foster a culture of innovation and collaboration. And realizing that is going to be a process of continuing to do these innovation boosts, which are events that bring people together to identify gaps and really start to pull more people into idea generation to kind of boost either existing businesses or organizations, or help start some new organizations that could be responsive to kind of challenges and gaps in the marketplace in different kind of domains. So we had a boost in kind of the oyster environment, and so we're really trying to, fundamental to the strategy and informed by the planning process. We worked with consultants doing what was called a story of place, really learning about kind of what has historically been successful here, so that we can be really approaching our kind of regional economic development with greater collaboration in a way that leverages kind of what has been successful. What are our core assets? How can we build upon what we have here, what we're so good at, like underwater sea naval, technologies is like case in point. So, and the boosts are really going to help to make that a more kind of public participatory process, because, the other kind of key part of our strategy is really helping to kind of build human capital, so to speak. So, we're very interested in doing all the things that are going to retain the talent that comes here through EB and other major employers. But we are also really trying to initiate processes that make entrepreneurship and small business success and growth more successful. And so, people who are moving through those boosts, coming up with ideas, we're also looking at a business accelerator program. So I've been talking with the Groton school system about that being installed there, as well as some other sites, so that when people are helped to come up with ideas, they now have a kind of a training program that they can go into to help them move that forward. So we expect a lot more business development to be resulting from that. So the third kind of leg of kind of that strategic kind of goals, in addition to innovation, human capital development, is placemaking. And really doing the investments that are going to make this place kind of stickier and more viable for private investment. And so some of what that's going to look like is asking the state to support pre-development analysis for Fame Street and Hodges Square in New London, points of connectivity between the city of New London and communities of Groton. The water taxi, absolutely. So that's kind of the bigger picture of how we have kind of come together around a strategic plan, and all of the projects that we're identifying are really in response to those larger goals.
Greg?
I'll make a motion to further endorse the ongoing TRIP project by approving a letter of support which directly assists the future implementation grant application submittal.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilor Grimm, a second by Councilor Morasic. Is there any more discussion on this? Application is being brought forward, like you said, by New London, Groton, the city of Groton, the school systems,
Spark. Pure Innovation Commons, Connecticut College.
So that with, if the money, if you receive the grant, it's possible that the money could be spent or land in New London, or it could land in the town of Groton, or it could land in the city of Groton. It could go anywhere, right? It might, not necessarily earmarked for Groton, because we're a, because we're, you know, in this together with a lot of different people. You know, how is it gonna, how will that be decided? I know it's kind of putting the cart a little bit before the horse, because we haven't gotten any money yet, but is, like, how is it determined? Because there's so many players. You know, obviously, we would love to have it in Groton, understanding that if it landed in New London, it's gonna benefit us in some way, and vice versa, but how is that, you know, how is that gonna play out? Do you have any idea?
Well, I certainly think, you know, something like the community concierge and performing these, like, innovation boosts are examples of project work that we're gonna be doing, which will just be, have a clear regional benefit, that you can't really say, this is just gonna benefit one community. So, you know, there's certainly that dynamic. But we're also, you know, part of what was really identified in the story of place process is that our places are all like small enough that that the success of all of us is really going to be enlivened through networking and to kind of create a critical mass. So I don't, like, we will not just be having that money go to support, you know, downtown New London, for example, because we want to, like, activate the different kind of hotspots that are downtown Groton and kind of Thames Street to create, like, a network of really interesting places. And so, you know, the team that's coming together is really looking at this as an opportunity for substantiating regionalization. And so there's really a lot of excitement about this as an opportunity to really help us work together. So there's, like, a strong kind of urge to be kind of collaborative and not competitive.
Okay, thank you. Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstention? That passes 8-0. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's 6:05. Should we go to the first item, which was the zoning regulations rewrite update joint meeting with the zoning commission? I see Sue's here and several members of the zoning commission are here. If they could come up, we're gonna all go down here. Or we're gonna.
You'd like to do?
Why don't we all go down to the? What's that?
Depends on how many bodies are already.
Okay. You'd rather stay here?
We don't have enough.
I'd rather stay here.
Okay, we're gonna stay here.
Oh yeah, it's exciting. It's a lot of money to be saved.
As long as we don't have that this year.
Hi, Sue. How are you?
Thank you, Mayor Flax. It's great to be here tonight.
Nice to have you all. Thank you for coming. Do you guys, do you need to call your meeting to order?
Yes, I would like to call.
Okay, go ahead.
I don't have my gavel. That's why I was missing. I'm just kidding. But I'd like to call the Town of Groton Zoning Commission meeting to order, do a roll call. And I guess tonight I would ask Susan Archer if you would be seated for Susan Sayer. And so we do have a quorum.
Great.
So we welcome it now to any new business you might have.
Great, thank you. So we again appreciate everybody coming tonight, and we've had a couple of discussions, as you know, at council, and we're gonna try to bring some things to light for everybody. We wanna remind all the councilors that this is not a meeting about WPRD, so that the Water Resource Protection District regulations that are being rewritten and discussed at zoning cannot be discussed here. There can't be any questions about the regulations. There can be discussion about meetings and how the meetings are, you know, what's happening in the meetings, that kind of thing. I think that's part of our issue. So, again, we appreciate you coming tonight. And I would open the floor up to councilors to start the meeting.
Okay, or if you would like, I'd be happy to give a brief introduction about the zoning commission.
Would you do that? Thank you.
I'd like to do that for one reason. I guess I'm very proud of the group we have. I think we're diverse, well-balanced, many with advanced degrees, collaborative group. And just to give you an idea, and this is our permanent commissioner committee members, there's someone with a big business background. We have senior engineers. We have someone with a really good planning background, and we have an attorney. So it's a good mix of people, I think, that bring different perspectives. So, and we're very interested in improving the zoning regulations, updating them. Anything that we can do to make our commission and the process more friendly to business, that's our goal. So anyway, at this point, be happy to open it up to any questions.
Okay, thank you.
I have a question.
Okay.
Were they privy to Harry's email?
John, was the Harry's email forwarded at all? The information in Harry's email?
I don't know if Harry's email specifically was forwarded, but I think that was the one of the questions that was raised at the last council meeting that we discussed. I did forward to all the commission members, I believe, kind of the section within the audio video of where the council was discussing the zoning commission meeting. But
okay.
I don't know if you want to paraphrase from Harry's email, or I certainly could do that.
Yeah, I think, did you want to take care of that, Bonnie?
Sure. It's addressed to town manager and to the mayor, and it came from Harry on last Thursday. No, 2 February. Last night, Bonnie and I, which is me, attended the zoning commission meeting. It appears they are at the point with the new regs to go to the public hearing. I have concerns about how the meeting was conducted. I got an agenda entering the room and was surprised to see the public get up from time to time giving comments. This was way past the part of the agenda for public comment. I was not there for the beginning, so perhaps they suspended the rules before I arrived. When an agenda is posted, in my opinion, it is for the public to know the format of the meeting in advance. For something so important as rewriting the regs, everyone should know up front what format is to be followed. On one side of an issue could be more represented than another, should someone know in advance how the meeting's going to be conducted. Beyond that, rewriting the zoning regs is important for our town to protect resources and streamline the process to raise the grand list. I don't know all that they have discussed and the pros and cons to their decisions. However, I would like a town council refer to get an update and planning and summary from planning, which is why we were discussing it. And with a public hearing in the near future, please have this on the agenda soon. So I concur, as I was there, that the meeting was not really run according to Robert's rules. And I feel the same way Harry did.
Okay. Well, I appreciate those comments. Yeah, it's unfortunate councilors don't attend more meetings. You could see what happens. And I think there's also, it's unfortunate Harry wasn't there at the beginning of the meeting either. But nonetheless, there's several ways you can run a meeting when you're talking about something as intense as zoning regulation updates. And we find that the public, I think, from many different points of view, does have a lot of comments they want to make. People can make every comment they have at the public comment section if they want to. So they do have noticed this is going to be an opportunity. We found, though, because there's so much back and forth in these, we discuss it. Sometimes we have new ideas. Sometimes, for example, I think at the last meeting, the business people had some new ideas. And I did announce at the beginning of the meeting it would be open to comments throughout, because this way, if an issue comes up, you can deal with it right then and there. If we didn't do this, in my opinion,
would lead to a very inefficient process, and we were probably months behind where we are in trying to update these regulations. This is a invitation that's open to everybody in the audience. It doesn't exclude anybody from making every comment they want to when they want to. They can do it during public comment, or they're allowed to also make comments later. We found an awful lot of people have taken advantage of this, and it's really made it much more interactive and much more efficient.
I think to Harry's point and to your discussion after, I understand what you're saying, but I think that the one of the things that is a genesis of this is that I see Zell's here, and I know Zell was in attendance there, and he was referred to speak to. You would call on him. You would bring up something. I wasn't there, and I know I talked to Harry about it. There would be a point brought up, and Zell would stand up and comment on it. Mm-hmm. And he clearly knew that these points were coming up, and was, invited to speak about it. Announcing at the beginning of a meeting that the people are welcome to make public comment, although lets everybody there know, doesn't let the general public know that that option is there. And so I refer to Zell, but Zell was there and he was ready to go. And there were other people who might have wanted that same opportunity, but if they were reading, if they missed the public comment and decided not to go, or knew that that was, that ability to speak at each point in the meeting, then it would, that might change the way it goes. So to me, it seemed unbalanced. So that's one of the issues that we have.
No, I appreciate how it seemed that way, maybe to someone who hadn't been there for the year plus, we've been going over this. But I would say that everybody knew, the agenda's published on the website. Everybody knows what's coming up, and Zell could read whatever he wanted to at the beginning of the meeting, or he could bring it up at the time it's appropriate. And it is, Robert's Rules does allow you the flexibility of changing that sort of thing. I would say also, someone like Dave Cody also used it to advantage later on to bring up comments too. So it wasn't just one person, there were other folks as well in other meetings that have made that, because sometimes, you'll think of something later on, any one of the groups can, and this allows them to make what's often a very good comment, and we can incorporate it right then and there, get back to them, commission can discuss it, and then move forward. I appreciate why you may say that, but I think anyone coming, they can come to a meeting, they can say whatever they want, they can say it all at once, or I gave them the opportunity to wait, hear more things, and make comments throughout the meeting. And I do think that helped take months off this project.
Mm-hmm. Deb, would you? Go ahead, Dean.
I think that there's a, no, I don't think. I'll stop using the qualifiers. I know that there's an impression that the Groton Open Space Association is more intimate with the Zoning Commission than perhaps it should be. I'm just saying that's the impression. I've heard it, I think we've all heard it. I'm just gonna get right to the heart of the matter. I've actually had somebody argue to me that all members of land use agencies should be members of that organization as a prerequisite to being members of the bodies. That's probably the most extreme formulation view that I've heard, and I understand the importance of the commission. I understand there are people that would, I've had arguments with Pauline Sheets, who argued with me that clean air and clean water are not special interests. So you can take, Goza and Avalonia and all that off the table, everybody else's special interests, and they're not. I get it. How would you, given the fact that we're a small town, given the fact that people know each other, they're married to each other, how do you guard against the impression that a land use agency such as yours has too close of a relationship with an outfit like the Groton Open Space Association?
Well, I would ask you the same thing, since it's really the town council that appoints commissioners.
Right.
Right?
Well,
that's the control.
Right. That's true, but I don't know that anybody's,
I guess
maybe if you've heard that people think that we're too close with GOES or another organization, do let me know. But right now, I'm dealing with the impression that your organization, your board, is too intimate. How, what would your response to people who have that suspicion be?
Well, I think I'd go back to my, the response I just said. I was just reappointed for 5 years. But anyway, I think the town council is the first opportunity to have a good process for making sure you get the right people on your commissions. But I think, second of all, I would say look at our track record, come to our meetings. You'll find in the, I don't know how long I've been on the commission. I know Steve has us all beat. I think he just got a award for, how many years was it? 25 years he's served on the zoning commission, which is, I think he deserves a citation from the town council. But anyway, when you look at all the applications we've seen, I think in at least the 10 years I've been on it, we've virtually approved every single application. We work with businesses to try to make it happen. If they're a grandfathered business that wants to expand their 50% in, say, the WRPD zone or something else, we work with them. These are not turned down and people run away, you know, not getting a good answer, not getting a quick answer. We are happy to hear them, talk to them. And if you look at the applications that have come in, you will see that I think we have an excellent track record. Downtown Mystic, I think we really took the time to talk to the residents, we talked to the businesses, and came up with some really practical, good solutions that seemed to be working as well as could be expected. So I guess that would be pretty much my answer on that. We want to make things happen. We want to see how we can figure it out, given our regulation constraints, but also trying to listen to both sides of each argument, too.
And what confuses attendance by certain organizations at our meetings as any kind of collusion or anything? Because it's, they just show up. And so if that's the impression you're getting, because an organization might show up to every meeting, I give them credit for staying involved.
No, I would give, but I would give them credit as well.
Economic development, anybody else could show up every month also.
No, that's my point. They're minding their business. I've got no problem with that. Yeah. It's not my impression. It's an impression. We hear things. So I'm simply relaying that to you. I don't know whether anybody else is relaying that to you, but I'll do the dirty work. I'll relay that to you. So,
yeah, I don't see what the... Trying to find out
impact.
What would be the impact?
Yeah, has been. I just don't see it in our record, and I'd welcome anyone to look at our track record and let us know.
If we were shooting down at a project, and it seemed to be influenced by GOSTO or somebody else, I mean that would be some kind of statistical evidence. But I think if you look, there's
so essentially there's not even any smoke. Never mind the fire.
Exactly.
Okay.
I think that one of the, you're saying that you know, everything's approved, and I'll piggyback on what Dean is saying, but the direction that the regulations are going in with respect to the I don't want to talk about specifics or anything, but the recommendations that are being made are in the opposite of what the consultants have placed there, and if approved, could affect development in Groton. So I think that that certainly was a red flag. Whether it's true or not, that is a red flag to us. And so when you're saying that everything gets approved and we don't turn anything away and it's back, but that was to us an indication that there's more, I don't know what the right word, not collusion, and maybe collusion, but there's influence from, let's say, GOSA on the decisions that are being made at your level and the zoning commission's level.
Are you saying this for regulations that have been approved already by the zoning commission?
No, recommended.
Well, then, you can't have not It's not a done deal yet, right?
True, but
it's in process, so we can't talk about it anyway.
Agreed.
I'll go back to our track record. And I think also, I guess the other frustration we have a little bit is we wish there were more applications, you know? We think we do a really good job. We think we're fair. We know our stuff. We've got the expertise. And we would wish somehow that there was just more for us to look at. There's certainly a lot for this commission to do. There's an awful lot for the planning commission to do, too. They meet twice as often as we do, with the exception of they, of course, update the POCD every 10 years, and now we're working on the zoning regulations, and that increases a lot the workload. But I think that's the major thing. I guess when I visit other towns and whatever, there are a lot of applications, and I just wish, you know, hopefully as the business economy improves, and I know you're all working on a lot of things to make that happen, we look forward to having some bigger things to look at and to get through downtown and business district, mixed use. We're ready to go on that. And I think having the regulations updated will put us in really good shape. I don't think it stops business having the regulations like they are, because if you have a big project come in, usually they have a representative that's quite expert and could read any regulations, whether well-written or up-to-date or not. And town staff is great to work with everyone who comes in. But anyway, we're hoping that things are gonna get really busy for us even after the regulations are updated.
Professor Perizzotti and Bonnie.
Hi, everybody. This is not the first time we have been together, is it? I just have a couple of questions. Does your commission in general feel that you follow Robert's rules?
Yes, I would say so.
Okay.
And I speak on myself, and I will say
anybody at the table can answer my question.
No, I'm just, that's why I wanted to throw
the that book right there is Robert's rules, right?
Yes.
It is.
And that comes to every meeting. And you can see it's well tattered.
Okay, so for the majority of you feel as though Robert's rules are followed on a meeting-to-meeting basis?
I think, not to get pedantic, but I think there's different ways of following Robert's rules, too. I have read Robert's rules, which I don't recommend, but it's good to get a sense. And I think what Robert's rules does, in essence, is really ensure a democratic process, a fair process, and that's what we're trying to do.
Okay.
So I think it's a good background for that.
So you made an interesting comment, though, because you use us, the town council, as a basis that we follow Robert's rules, but we also have an agenda that we follow. Mm-hmm. And the thing that really disappoints me the most is under our public comment, anybody in this town, country, can know that they can show up here and speak under public comment. And that's the only time that they can speak under public comment, unless they are recognized by one of us to speak. So my first recommendation is, if you are going to not really follow Robert's rules and kind of make it a little bit more of an open forum type meeting, then you need to make it clear in your agenda under public comment that it can be accepted at any point during the meeting. Because if that is how your commission is going to run, I want you to know from me personally that that is one of my expectations. That way, anybody on any public comment on any issue can come at any time during your meeting, be recognized, and be able to speak. Because for me, you're cutting the system. Personally, okay. That is my impression of what is happening right now.
I appreciate it.
It's just me.
I appreciate
I'm not
your
speaking
feedback.
For anybody else.
I appreciate your feedback. Councilor Perizzotti, and I think I've answered the question. And I would say anyone who was to speak later, as I'd announced they could, was recognized.
But it needs to be in writing on your agenda.
We will
that
definitely,
is posted.
We will take that into consideration. And I do appreciate your comments.
Okay. As I said, this is not the first time that we have been here in regards to Robert's rules. There was a time back in 2008 where there was a citizen's petition that went to the Zoning Commission because people were having issues. Back in November of 2011, you were brought back here again because tape recorders were being turned off. Okay? This is the third time since I've been a counselor that the zoning commission is now in front of us again.
Okay, well, I just say.
It's getting tired. We shouldn't have to have you guys in here because you're not following the rules and making it a fair and far and open process. I'm having a really hard time with this.
The committee, the whole agenda was not about the topic that you're talking about. But nonetheless, we were talking about the zoning regulation update process. But I will say years ago, that allegation, I think, was cleared up satisfactorily for the zoning commissioner involved. So if you wish, we could furnish you the background on that.
Nope.
What looked like a problem turned out to be quite the opposite. So be happy to get that for you.
And just for just disclosure purposes, I am on the Personnel and Appointments Committee, and I do take it pretty importantly as far as who we choose to put on certain boards and regulations. I feel it's my due diligence to make sure that every board and commission is as balanced as possible. And I will tell you, completely straightforward, the one time that I asked somebody, do you have any kind of affiliation outside of this commission that you feel might possibly interfere with your judgment, and I gave the example of Groton Open Space, I got berated with emails from members of GOSA calling me discriminatory, calling me unfair. So I would just like to state for the record, we as a Personnel and Appointment Committee try our hardest to make sure that every board and commission is balanced as much as possible. So, you know, these are some things that you've said along the meeting tonight, and I just want to make it clear that we try to ask the right questions and we try to do our homework. But if people do not disclose and are honest with what they are involved in and aren't honest about what might influence their decisions, we end up in situations like this, where Councilor Antipas is coming to you and saying, there is a certain perception out there. We don't know how we're supposed to deal with perception if people are not open and honest about the positions that they choose to be on as far as the commissions are concerned.
Well, I would just say, I think this kind of reflects my opening remarks, kind of introducing the commission. I would say you're doing an excellent job, because I think the Zoning Commission is a really fine group that's been put together. So, and I appreciate the recent alternate appointments, including Susan here. I think they'll be really great additions. They're participating in our meetings, and I think it's working out really well. So I see it as, I think you're doing a very fine job, actually.
Yeah, I just want to say to Councilor Parazotti's point, there's no way for us to find out who is a member of Groton Open Space. Their membership is not listed on their website. And so just what she said, I mean, we don't have any idea if we're padding an entire zoning commission with members that are all GOSA members or whether they're not. So it's a difficult thing for us to find out. But I will say that during that meeting, I don't even know Mr. Zell's first name. He was treated almost with reverence, and when the woman from Cardinal Honda got up, she was pretty much dismissed quickly and told to talk to staff at the town. And so the perception to me clearly that night was not weighted fairly.
Okay, thank you again, Councilor Nault, for your comments. But I would refer you to the woman from Cardinal Honda's points, and I'm not going to get into this because this is the application, but if you would refer to the minute meetings, she made a very significant and constructive point, which we immediately acted upon. Okay? I thought that was a chance for her to talk later in the meeting. She made the right point, and we made the right changes to make it much more business friendly for their organization, which is a big player in Groton. Big business player.
Very big.
Councilor Barber?
I have to tell you that I wasn't there, and I wish I was, because it sounds like the meeting was manipulative. Mm-hmm. and I have to back Councilor Perizzati and Councilor Noel and Councilor Watson. I'm troubled that you interpret Robert rules your own way, that it's pretty much black and white, and we are very diligent about following them, so it would be fair for everybody concerned. So I'm very concerned about what's happening with this.
Yes. No, I appreciate that, Councilor Barber.
Yeah.
And like I said, we will follow up on this one point, too. We'll certainly
Can I just make one clarification? There is not the ability for the public to speak at any time during our meeting. We have an open hearing, and there is a time in that hearing that we request public comment. Now, during that time, the public is free to speak. If the hearing gets closed, if we go on to other subjects, no public comment is accepted. So I just want to clarify that in case anybody thinks that this is the Wild West out there. And, you know, anybody can speak at any time.
But doesn't that, what you're saying goes in opposite of what?
No, we're at the same meeting every month.
I know, but you're saying that once the public comment portion is closed, that nobody can speak. And Sue's saying that she announced at the beginning that people could speak at any time, and as you went point by point, they were allowed to speak.
Well,
it's not a public hearing.
Go ahead. At the last meeting, it was more of a wind-up that we were, you know, putting the final touches, we'll say, on what we were doing. And there was a time that, you know, any final comments does the public have? And that's all we went through. It was a, you know, kind of point counterpoint type thing going on. But once the hearing is closed, once we're on to other business, there's
But
there's
that
no
meeting wasn't a public hearing, was it?
Not that section. No.
Yeah. So
there was a final edits for the regulations.
Okay.
Proposed regulations.
So I'm sorry, what you're saying is it just
no, it's actually
be clear, it's not what you're saying.
If you have a public hearing, like Steve was saying, there's a time when the public can speak. At some time during the public hearing, you close the comments.
Right.
Right. Right. And after that point, the public cannot speak.
Now, that one meeting that we had, the public was invited to speak. And, you know, if it was not posted, we will make sure that that is, you know, but every other meeting we had, and there were many, you know, the process, you know, it was always that there was a set time for public speaking, and anybody could speak it, you know, during that time.
Okay. So, Sue, is it all Sue's? It's Sue and
it's
Sue,
It's a
right?
requirement. I think it's
Sue.
It's a requirement.
It's a town council requirement.
It's diverse as it seems.
Do either of the Sue's have any comments? That, I mean, we welcome comments from the commissioners as well.
Trying to figure out exactly how to say this without going into things that we're not allowed to talk about in this forum is a little difficult, but I think we're tap dancing around a single issue, and I'm speaking about this from the perspective of being a statistician. I would wonder if the perception that is in the community, and I would have no knowing, but if the perception that the things that you're hearing, if you will, are coming from a huge number of people, or a handful of people, or three or four people who are very vocal because they have a vested interest. Because that tempers how people speak, and on a what you're getting is what is essentially called voluntary response and statistics, which means you're getting information from people that they are choosing to give you. Voluntary response information is traditionally and historically either very, very positive or very, very negative. That's where you get the most of your information. And of those two groups, these people who have something that they feel negatively about are much more often apt to speak when they have a concern. If they came to the meeting and sat at the meeting and they were happy with the outcome of the meeting, I doubt that you heard from them.
Agreed.
And I think from being, you know, new to the community, I think the meetings are very well run. I think we hear an awful lot from an awful lot of people very quickly. Perhaps we need to change the agenda so that we reflect things better, that then you don't have concerns about the direct following of Robert's rules. But this is the community in which these people live and work and own businesses. And I think it was, you know, it was extremely time consuming, but there were an awful lot of people who got to speak. Some of them were very happy with what they heard. Some of them were mildly pleased with the response they got, and some were going to walk away displeased. That's, I'm sure you experience that yourselves when people come to a town council meeting. But when you're hearing things in the community, I would ask that you consider, how often do you get comments about this council or any other council where that person is saying, oh, they did a great job. I was really glad that I went to the meeting. Because there have to be, that side has to be there by the law of large numbers. That has to work.
Dean?
Yeah, I'm not going to address whether the sample size is sufficiently, sufficiently large enough, but I'm not a stranger to presentations by people who are unhappy because they got an application turned down by planning, by zoning, by wetlands, by somebody. You're always going to have these unhappy people. I like to think that I'm able to filter that out. So I appreciate the suggestion. That's already being carried, at least in my mind, that there are people that are, will always be squeaky wheels. They've got a reason to be squeaky. That's not what I'm talking about. Thank you.
Sue, do you have anything you want to say? Sue,
great. I haven't read Robert's rules in quite a while, so evidently I need to read them again. Okay. So.
I would say that, to your point, Sue, and you know, to be completely honest, I think from my standpoint, we had these regulations getting rewritten. John, Paige, I think the council has been very supportive economic development-wise. I think also that the council cares about the environment. I don't think that we're out to ruin the environment. I think that we put a lot of faith in how John and Paige go about their business and how they go about getting things going for the town. And I know I think we all know that these regulations are a very important cog in moving the town in an economic direction. To your point, you said, how often do you get comments, right? I mean, things go along every day. It's rare that I get a comment about the council, right? But when you do get a comment, it sometimes does raise a flag and say, boy, you know, we never hear anything. What's the issue? And so with that, with the particular thing that we're talking about that we're not going to say, the difference in the regulation is the difference in economic development in some areas in the town. So that's why it raised a flag for me. I think that's the reason that there was councilors who went to the meeting, because they wanted to hear what was going on. We knew that at this meeting there was talk and there was going to be information about this particular regulation. And so to go to that meeting with that flag of what's going on and see what we saw is what raises the flag and turns it red, because in your everyday, we don't go to the meetings every day. So you think that the meetings are being held and everything's kind of copacetic. And when you have a couple of counselors go, like Councilor Watson, Councilor Null, and are surprised, it makes us have a kind of meeting like this and makes us delve deeper, because it's very important to the community on both sides. And Councilor Watson, although he's not here, he is pretty easygoing. And if he's getting worked up over something, he has a long history in the town. And he is, I think, very well respected. And if he's coming up with an issue or, saying, oh my gosh, I can't believe, I'm going to listen. And so, I stopped into that meeting for a few minutes. I think Councilor Nault and Councilor Watson stayed longer than I did. But that's the kind of the genesis of the meeting. So, I think it's a good discussion to have. And when those red flags or white flags get raised, for us too to look into them and see what's going on. Because it's if we hadn't, we wouldn't we wouldn't have a window into the meeting and see what was happening, and you have to assume that that window that we saw on that night is an everyday window, and so those things that are happening in that meeting are happening in other meetings.
Yeah, actually, it was not a, if you look at all of our meetings, it would not be the normal way at all. But we are trying to get these regulations done. We were trying to finish up the last nits and nats, so hopefully we're going to be there shortly, so, and get on to the rest of regulations, which I think the consultants are, they're on board, they're pushing it, and I think doing a very good job to make them much better than what they are now.
So. I'm just curious, when's your next meeting?
It's going to be the first Wednesday of every month is ours. So.
I just ask one final question before you guys
sure.
go. I see that you often do not meet when, Sue, you're not available. Is that?
I'm sorry, Bruce, I'd have to know the exact dates
okay.
and I could give you an explanation.
Well, I'm just wondering, how often does the Zoning Commission meet and you're not chairing?
Well, I literally schedule my vacation so I can try to attend the town meetings because I made a personal commitment to be on the commission. So.
Well, and I don't want to misquote.
So I know there was no meeting, I guess the February meeting, which we had thought we had a quorum, and then Steve yeah. was called away on a business trip, you know, because he has a senior position at EB, so that happens.
So when you go out of the country, and it's during the time that there's meetings, there's no meetings, we just push it off until?
No, we had planned that. That was all set to go on last, we had a quorum, but last minute Steve was called out, I think literally a day or so before the meeting, so he's called to Washington. Much more than I am. So.
Right.
But no, we try to always have the meetings go on. I'm not critical to the meeting at all. We have a very strong staff. Yeah. So.
But in the times that you haven't been there, we've had myself or someone else.
Right, yeah, Steve, in fact, there were two in a row.
Okay.
Yeah. I think two in a row, Steve was chair. So.
I'll go to Deb, John, Page. You guys have anything you want to add?
I think it is, although some of these conversations may often be difficult, I think it's important for the Zoning Commission to hear the priorities of the council. I mean, we certainly bring back to the commission, you know, as we're working on things, the market analysis, the regulatory audit, and the impressions that we're getting from the council of what your priorities are. I think it is important for all the boards and commissions to know what your priorities are. If economic development is priority one, then I think it's important for our land use committees to know that, and hearing that from you is something that I think will help keep that in mind as we move forward. Understanding the direction that we're all going in so we can all be going in the same direction, I think is something very important.
Thank you. Deb?
I just want to say that the Zoning Commission really has been working really hard on the regulations, and quite often they've been shorthanded. Just recently we've gotten a couple of new appointees, but they've been really diligent about showing up once and sometimes twice a month to work on the regs.
Thank you. Paige, do you have anything you want to
add? Sorry?
Paige, did you have any?
Yeah.
Mark? I think it should, we'd be remiss, I'd be remiss if I didn't say that, you know, we appreciate the fact that you are all volunteers. And you are coming in on your own time, and for that, thank you very much for your support of the town and what you do for the town.
Okay. And thank you, too, for all the work you do.
What's that?
You really put the hours in. We appreciate it.
Anybody? Do you guys want to call your, dismiss your meeting? Or?
Yes, I'll take a motion to adjourn. Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Abstain? Okay. Thank you very
right,
much for your time. Thank you, gentlemen.
So the next item is a 2016-0277 disposition of town-owned property acquired in tax foreclosure. And Mark?
Sure. A month or so ago, you reviewed an item concerning seven different properties, two of which the staff was recommending we attempt to sell or dispose of, and five of which, for various reasons, we are recommending, at least for the time being, you hold on to. As part of that process, there was a what we call an 8-24 referral to the Planning Commission. You do have the response back. From the commission, they are in support of the recommendations that were put back.
I'll have to get back to you.
And we did reissue the fold-out map.
Okay.
Just to refresh your memories as to which properties we were recommending that we go ahead and try to sell. And there is a table a couple pages before that map that looks like this. Mm-hmm. And so there are seven properties identified. Two of them are on Long Hill Road in the vicinity of the Bridge Street Kings Highway area. These are properties that, while they have frontage onto Route 1, they do not have access from Route 1. And we're recommending, or had recommended, and still are recommending, we retain those. The Planning Commission concurred. The third property is on Joe Avenue, which is located in the city. The recommendation was to sell, and the Planning Commission concurred with that. The fourth property is on Long Hill Road. This is commonly referred to as Boulder Heights, but maybe more recently has been referred to as the property, the replacement property for the Merritt property, where it's proposed that a new middle school be built. This is in back of Applebee's, down the road, in back, backs up to I-95. And obviously, the recommendation there was to retain, since we need it as a replacement property for the Merritt property. The sixth property, the fifth and sixth property are on Marty Lane. This is the infamous Grove Avenue subdivision area. These are two very small parcels that at this time we're suggesting we should retain for potential future disposition, but instead of starting to sell these properties, the recommendation is we wait and see what happens to the rest of the properties associated with that proposed subdivision. And then the last one is out on Rogers Road in the northeast area of town. The recommendation was to sell. And as I noted, the Planning Commission did review these seven items and concurred with the recommendations as presented by staff.
So you're looking for us to move?
Correct.
From the...
Unless you have any other questions since the last time we all talked.
Great.
I'll make a motion to sell the property on Rogers Road and Joe Avenue and retain the other properties mentioned.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? That passes 8-0-0. Brings us to 2017-0061, Supportive Housing Program Grant.
The next three items all concern human services, and this is kind of the time of year that these three grants come up. The first one, the supportive housing. The town does get some money from TVCCA to support some supportive housing activities. We're considered, as noted in the referral memo and also in my staff, write-up, a collaborating agency of TVCCA. These dollars are basically supplant some partial salary and related fringe benefit expenses on human services staff. There's no matching funds required. They're actually, if you look at the proposed budget in years past and in the future, these are part of the financing plan for that particular department.
Thank you. Would you like to, anybody have any, would someone like to move the grant?
I'll make a motion to authorize the town manager to enter into an agreement with TVCCA to accept the funding in the amount of $9,000.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? That passes 8-0-0. Next one is 2017-0062, Department of Education, Youth, and Family Services Funding.
These are dollars that the department gets to support youth and family services types of activities. This is a recurring grant, and matching funds are required the funds are already built into the budget of the department. There's no additional funding that's needed. Once again, these are grant dollars that have been part, for many years, part of our financing plan for the Human Services Department. The last amount of funding that we got was a little bit over $27,000. When we present it this way, because we're really not sure how much funding we're going to get. Hopefully, we get the same amount, but at this point, we're requesting funds. The state reviews the applications, and then they determine what agencies get what amount of funding.
Thank you. Karen?
I'd like to make a motion that we authorize the town manager to apply to the state of Connecticut for DOE funding for fiscal year ending 2018 for municipal grants in such an amount as will be determined and made available by DOE, and to amend contractual agreements for such funding to ensure continuation of short-term counseling, crisis intervention and prevention and support programs for Groton youth and families.
Second.
We have a motion by Councilor Moore, a second by Councilor Barber. Any further discussion? Councilor Shaw?
So what's the 7550 was the last grant?
That's the next one.
That's the next one. The last grant for this one was $27,242.
Oh, okay. I'm on the wrong one. So we have to match whatever the amount is in our budget?
We already have it in the budget. These are not really much different than the first grant. If we don't get these grant dollars, then we use general fund dollars. So it's not a dollar for dollar. We're one of the few agencies, the department is one of the few agencies that still gets this type of money from the state. When we put the budget together, we actually anticipate we're going to be getting these dollars. So I guess the matching dollars are whatever else. If we didn't get these grant dollars, would we have a youth and family services division in the department?
Well, I guess that's my question, because we haven't talked about that this year yet, whether we're going to approve that money. So tonight we're going to approve something that we haven't gone over in the budget?
I think we're just authorizing the application for the grant, right?
Yeah. Correct.
Yeah.
Yep.
But by doing so, whatever money we get, then we are obligated to match.
We're not locking our hands. First of all, these dollars, I think in Marge's, if ultimately you decide you want us to get out of this business, then we send the money back.
Okay. All right. Fine.
Anybody else? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? That passes 8-0-0. And the last one, 2017-0063, Department of Education Youth Services Enhancement Grant for $7,550.
Yeah, the $7,555 is what we've gotten in the past. It's another grant from the state of Connecticut Department of Education. It's entitled Enhancement Grant Program Funding. It's a recurring grant. Matching funds, once again, are required, but they're already in the budget. I should note, just really to follow up on Bonnie's observation, while we refer to this as fiscal year ending 17, actually the grant period is February for 17, was February 1st, 16 through January 31st, 17. So it's kind of a misnomer when they say fiscal year ending. It's really closer to a calendar year. So there some of these dollars would actually be used in the current year. We're anticipating that these dollars would be available in the current year. And these dollars are not for salary, these are for operating expenses, materials and supplies and so forth. And once again, the $7,500 is simply the amount we've gotten in the past. We may get more, we may get less, we may get nothing. Mm-hmm. That's yet to be determined.
Please ask for more.
I'll make a motion. Do you want to make a motion?
Please.
Okay. To authorize the town manager or designee to apply for the State of Connecticut Department of Education grant for FYE and the 18 Youth Services Bureau Enhancement Grant Program.
Second.
We have a motion by Council Perizotti, second by Council Barber. Any more discussions? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? That passes 8-0. Next is 2016-0260, FYE 2018 budget discussion.
Well, a couple things. I think everybody here now has the proposed budget. I don't know if everybody's had a chance to delve into it, but just very quickly, very unusual year. I mean, we're always somewhat flying blind in terms of the money that we may get from the state, but not as much as this year. As you will note in the budget, we've identified four potential scenarios, and that's all they are, is they're scenarios. The first scenario is basically saying we don't believe anything in the governor's budget proposal is going to come about. Let's simply use the revenues from the state that we anticipate getting this year. That's scenario one. Scenario two is we're using the current year estimates as what we think we're going to get from the state and deducting $5 million. It could have been $3 million, it could have been $7 million. It's simply a plug number to have a discussion. That scenario is the scenario that I'm using to put forth the proposed budget. So when you look at the mill rate and so forth, it's scenario two. Scenario three is the governor's proposed budget, including the reduction in ECS funding, which essentially comes out to a little bit over $9 million, $9.2, $9.3 million. And scenario four, the worst scenario, is the governor's proposal with respect to ECS funding, plus the other $4 million that he's proposing that Groton would have to pay as our share for the teacher retirement or the pension fund. The one-third co-pay, so to speak. I know a number of you were able to go to the session last night at Fitch, and there were a couple of, which I thought was a very good discussion. There were a couple of takeaways, but nothing's in stone. But at a couple of occasions, the legislators, Heather Summers and Joe Dela Cruz, I think the first thing they indicated is that for the most part, they don't feel, and correct me for those of you who were at the meeting last night, they don't feel that there's any legs to the governor's proposal to have towns pay the one-third teacher retirement. I heard that pretty clearly, at least where I was seated. The other thing that was mentioned, they were asked hypothetically that, if they were on the town council, since they both had been on the town council, what would their recommendation or suggestions be as to how to proceed? And the comment that I believe Heather made was, well, maybe pick a midpoint. So that's essentially what scenario two is. And I'm not advocating for, I had to pick something. I could have picked scenario one as easily as scenario two, three, or four. And I once you've had a chance to digest my budget message, which has a lot of similar stuff in it that we have in the past, but it also is talking about the process, a suggested process that the council may want to consider with an eye, or at least acknowledging that probably by the time you're done with the budget, end of April, we're not going to be any smarter with respect to what's going on in Hartford. And while there's been a lot of talk about extending a time frame, that's really not going to be very helpful either. I mean, a week or two may be helpful, but the fact of the matter is we need to send tax bills out so we have money to be able to begin operations in July. So there may be a little bit of time if there's some relief provided. We don't have the ability to give ourselves relief, and I go into that in some detail in the budget message, and that The charter is very specific as to what dates and timeframes we have to follow. There is a piece of legislation that, Mike Carey was here before, I just wanted to acknowledge his good work on this, that we had talked about that is in effect. It was something that was approved last year during the state budget deliberations, and it appears to be in effect through the end of June. That possibly would give us some relief to gain another week or two. But there's also talk in Hartford of possibly providing kind of universal extensions to communities that either have charters or are governed by ordinances. I'm not sure any of that is really very helpful at the end of the day. I think ultimately the council and the RTM should go about their deliberations doing the best that you can, and maybe keeping off to the side, depending on how you want to proceed, kind of a running list of either things that potentially could be cut further at some point in the future, or things that you've already cut that if the money comes through, or you recommended to cut, if the money comes through, could be added back in. And I don't know that there's a preference doing it one way or the other, but it's basically as a result of the council review, you make whatever adjustments you're gonna make, and you may wanna pass on to the RTM your thoughts about either restoring things that you've cut or other things that maybe would have to be cut, depending on what happens in Hartford. These are all very much uncharted waters, at least for me. I will say, though, that in the past, just a couple years ago, we were confronted with a situation not nearly to this mad order of magnitude, but we were confronted very early on into the new budget year, knowing that there was going to be a decrease in local and state funding. And town operations took it upon itself to identify around $650,000 worth of cuts, self-imposed cuts that we shared with the council to help mitigate that. And I have no doubt that, you know, if an assumption is made, whatever the assumption is, and it turns out worse that once the mill rate is set than we all anticipated, there's a way of dealing with that. And I think that's a discussion that, you know, not only we need to have, staff needs to have with the council, but staff and the council needs to also have with the RTM. I would suggest, particularly in light of what I heard last night, that you don't go into this budget session assuming the worst, because that's not what I heard. And I know Bonnie was there and Bruce, you were there. You may have heard something different than I did, but that's not my takeaway as, you know, okay, we need to cut the budget $14 million or $13 million or whatever it may be. I think it's more about the process and determining upfront what does everybody feel comfortable with in terms of a process. Do we go through the budget and do your normal due diligence and make adjustments? Or do you make some assumption about some reduced revenue at the state level and try to deal with that as you go through your deliberations as opposed to later on?
Bobby?
Last night, Heather, Senator Summers made it pretty clear that we should all be, everybody in that room and all the, anybody who's listening to this meeting should be writing all the members of the Appropriations Committee and ask every single one of them to try to get the budget done early. And then the other thing she requested was to write them, even if they don't represent Groton, and say how unfair the budget was. And she said that the response up there has been pretty reasonable, that we were very, very unfairly targeted because of all the reasons that you've been reading, and the Husky and the base and the base housing. So we should do that. She suggested doing it on bright green and pink postcards so that they notice it when it comes in their mail, and just try to barrage them with that. But as to town manager's budget, the best case scenario, in my opinion, is a terrible budget. It's outrageous. We can't pass that kind of tax hike on to the public. So,
yeah,
I was going through the scenarios, and I was just wondering, it's too bad we can't have a meeting where
we collectively can agree on whether it's scenario two or three or four. I think we ought to, so that when we start debating on what we're going to look at in various departments, we're all on the same page. You know, somebody might say, well, scenario one is good or two, and then Dump Bonnie will say, well, four is good, and I'm going to present my position this way. I think we need, as a council, should try at least to be on the same page so that we approach it that way.
Councilor DeBass?
I agree with Councilor Morasic. I think that for all the writing we do about the town manager's budget, it's a first draft. It always is a first draft, and we never pass exactly what the town manager wants. We pass our budget. So thank you for the draft, and we'll take it from here, and I guess we'll make our own assumptions regarding the revenues. And we may collectively, I don't know how we're going to fracture on this, we may unify behind one or another scenario, but an assumption has to be made, since you're right, we don't know. We know less than we do in any typical year. And I want to point something out. There's no solution to this one. I haven't done a survey of the other 168 towns, but I was struck going through my father's papers. My parents live in Stanford. And there in the drawer was a little document from the town of Stanford showing you where your money comes from, and you know, where the money comes from, where the money goes. I was amazed. About 93% of Stanford's budget, and it's a much larger town, bigger budget, but 93% of their dollars are raised, to support their budget, are raised through local taxes. Ours is like a two-thirds figure. We are very much at the mercy of what Hartford gives us. And that's sort of part of our problem. It's like a three-year-old versus a 13-year-old. The three-year-old needs mommy to feed him. The 13-year-old knows where the leftover pizza is. That's Stanford. We have to wait for the state to give us money because, God forbid, it's a much bigger deal for us than it is for a town like Stanford. I don't know what the solution is. You kind of wish that we were not as sensitive to the state funds as we are. We wouldn't be having these debates, but as long as we rely on this money, we're forever going to be sort of twisting in the wind when the state decides they can't pass the budget on time, they're going to hit us, et cetera. We need those dollars. So either we're going to work ourselves out of that by it's going to be a combination of either raising taxes over time, lowering expenses, finding a happy medium. I'd love to be off their tether.
Councilor Barber?
I think we need to get the superintendent of schools in and see how he can cut a couple million out of his budget. I don't think the town should be taking and being crippled by this scenario. I think that we are all in this together, and he's got to sharpen his pencil and help us out here.
Thank you.
I want to say, last night, Senator Summers talked about the corner of the state that pays, I forget what you said, to 95% of all the tax money that comes to the state comes from down there, because somebody at the hearing or the meeting said, you know, there was an article in the day, I think, about the millionaires and billionaires that are in the state, and, you know, kind of dismissing them, but as Senator Summers pointed out, without them, and they are leaving, she said there were 26 billionaires a couple years ago, and now it's down to whatever it is, 13, so because they're leaving the state, and so all that revenue that's coming from there, so you can't hold a grudge against them, but you know, I agree with Councilor Antipas. I mean, we don't have, when I testified up at the ECS hearing, the average home sale here in Groton is $220,000. The average home sale in Greenwich, Connecticut, which supposedly they think we are more affluent based on their formula, is $1.7 million. And so the people that live in our town can't afford to have their taxes increased.
Yeah.
So.
I don't think that, to Rich's point, I agree that we should be somewhat on the same page. If we're going, like, if we choose to go with the budget with the $5 million, you know, scenario two. And Mark, when you go with that budget, it puts in what the superintendent submitted for the schools, right? So, and without, at the starting point that you've submitted, what did the $5 million scenario, what did scenario two start at for an increase, like a, like what was the increase?
The mill rate increase?
Yes, yeah.
I don't have my budget in front of me, I think it was 3-point-something mils, if I remember correctly. So on Roman numeral five in your budget, I run through the four scenarios, but scenario two, the mill rate would go from 21.73 to 25.07, 3.34 mil increase.
Okay, which is like $9 million, was that what it was, like $9 million?
Yeah, a mil is around 3.6 million.
So if you see the loss of the $5 million, we're looking at increases of $4 million other places, whether it be a lack of other revenue or filling in funds, I think that you mentioned there's other.
The impact of the grant list went down a little bit because of the reval, so it's, yeah, there's a couple, yeah. There's an increase in the bottom line of the budget, so that's part of the increase. There was a reduction in the grant list. There is a reduction in other revenues,
yeah.
Too. But the big, you know, the $5 million is clearly saying, okay, we don't know what's gonna happen in Hartford, but let's assume for this scenario we get $5 million less.
Part of my concern is that the revenues that we got from the state last year were reduced, right? If, let's just say, it's $5 million this year, and we, you know, figure out, we cut a lot of stuff out, maybe the Board of Ed contributes, and we get down to a 2.5% increase, not mill increase, but 2.5% budget increase. And we, you know, we've kind of taken a hatchet to things a little bit. And then next year, the same thing happens. If the state keeps cutting $5 million each year, and we keep trying to lower tax, you know, make sure, we're gonna have no town left. We have no services left. We'll have safety and we'll have roads. And that's about the extent of it.
Yeah.
And so I think that, you know, for me, that if, that I'm not gonna let Hartford decimate our town. And if they're, you know, I think we need to take a look at every single line item, and the schools need to take a look at every single line item. But I'm not willing to go deep in cuts, and I think that people should realize that it's Hartford that's, you know, that's raising their taxes, if it should go that way. That, you know, we're trying to make a reasonable shot at what we should do, but I'm, you know, I'm not willing to cut out the whole town. But anyway, it's going to be an interesting budget session, season, not a pleasant one. Greg?
Yeah, I think it's just going to be important, you know, if we, both the council and the RTM deliberate, come up with a new mill rate based upon the $5 million, and that number changes, you know, that we have a chance to re-adjudicate, you know, the budget. So we have to figure that out. I think that's the most important part.
Yeah, I agree.
That's different this year, that we have to understand how we're going to go re-adjudicate those different numbers.
I agree with that. Does anybody have to Rich's point and to some other people's support, do we want to go with the $5 million scenario to go through the budget process with and come out at the end with whatever we come out with? Like, agree that we'll go with choice two, Rich?
Can you go in a caucus, the eight of you?
We can do anything. Yeah, we can go to a caucus.
And you tell me what you want.
And then.
Not going to be a party to that. I mean, I have no problem talking about this openly.
Yeah.
I don't have, myself, enough information. I mean, I know which way, you know, the bars go up or down, but I'm not ready to make a decision tonight about which scenario I would adopt for purposes of moving forward, so.
Councilor Morton?
I'm fully prepared to talk about it. I'm not gonna support anything that requires a big tax increase. Bottom line, I think we have a responsibility to represent the taxpayers of this town. I think there are more taxpayers that won't be able to afford a large tax increase than there are. I can't see where, as there may be a lot of people that say, I don't like it, but I'm willing to have my taxes raised because I don't want to give up the amenities, the services. I think there are more people who may be forced right out of their homes if there is a big tax increase. I'm looking to cut anything we're not mandated to provide, and I'll be very upfront about that. I'm going to go through this budget. If we're obligated by state statute or charter or federal law to provide something, then so be it. But if we, there's a lot of optional spending in the budget, things that we support, things in town where we have duplicates, various duplicate services. If we're not obligated to support them, I can't tax the town's taxpayers to continue providing them, and that's where I'm going to be coming
from.
I have to agree strongly with Councilor
Morton.
Well, I got so much on my mind. Again, the Board of Ed, I forgot my paperwork, but in 2001 to 2015, the budget went up $20 million with the Board of Ed, yet the enrollment went down 1,400 students. I have a real problem with that, so we really need to sit down and talk about it. The other thing is, there's a saying, which I'm not even going to say it, but it's, or get off the pot. We need to talk about maybe finally getting the dispatches together, maybe saving money there. This Groton City, Groton Town, so many police stations, so many public works, everything. It's time to stop talking about it and get something done, to put it all into one and start saving money, and then maybe we wouldn't have to cut the amenities that we have in this town. But it's time that we get smart and get it done.
Thank you. Councilor Grimm?
Yeah, I mean, I think we do need to pick, you know, an option to have a logical discussion about the budget, otherwise we're gonna be all over the place. So I support, you know, option two, and having an ability to re-adjudicate our decision based upon what the state finally ends up with after the fact.
Councilor Noel?
I just want to say I completely agree with Councilor Morton and Councilor Barber. I found it absolutely outrageous that the Board of Ed came in with an increase to their budget.
Absolutely.
When we already knew, whether it stands or not, looming $14 million, and then to come in and say we're increasing our budget when we specifically asked them when they came here for a zero budget. You made it very clear, and I made it clear, I thought they should come in under a zero budget, because we can't ask them to do that, but they can. And I mean, there's places that we have to do something to cut the budget.
I'm sorry, Councilor Ferrazzotti.
So this is never easy, ever, in all of the years we've sat here. I definitely agree with Mayor Flax's philosophy, though. I grew up here. I've been here all my life. I love this town. We have a lot of great amenities. Yep. We just have to make sure that we do our due diligence when we go through the budget by department. That's what I say every year. That's our job. That's what we are supposed to do. And yes, we are supposed to give as much guidance as possible. You know, I also don't have enough information. I mean, mine's still in the cellophane. Sorry, I just haven't gotten that far. I haven't been here, but I don't know if I have enough information or even read the scenarios to sit here and say that I want to be on one side or the other right now. I want to start off by saying I appreciate the effort that, you know, the town departments, Mark, that everybody has done to try to give us options to even start moving forward. That is more than we have ever started before in any years. So I just want to start off by saying thank you for even giving us an opportunity to look at four different scenarios. And I'm, like I said, I want to read through this. I want to at least see what the scenarios are before I go one way or another. But I'm going to go into it the same way I do every single year, and that's go through each department,
make the right choices for the right reasons at the right times for this town. And yes, there are a variety of different opinions out there. You do have the opinions that, you know, you're going to take Parks and Rec away? What do you mean? Or, oh, you're going to take the library away? Oh, what do you mean? We all have the things that we love about this town. We are never going to sit here as nine counselors and agree. That, I know that is not going to be an easy task. But as long as you can move forward and make the right decisions based on the reason why you're sitting here and know that you're doing the best choice that you can for our town, then all of us can sleep well at night. And you're right, I don't want to be at the mercy of Hartford anymore. And if we do continue to go down this path, we will not have a town anymore. And I like our town. I love our town. And that's how I'm moving forward with my decision this year.
Councilor Antipas?
I wanted to raise a point of order, and here's why. Because we've, strictly speaking, the issue that we started with was what scenario would we be prepared to adopt as an assumption moving forward? And the discussions that we're having, the comments that are being made are all useful, but there I see two different tracks. Some of us are talking about the scenarios, and some of us are talking about a general approach to the budget and not hitting the taxpayer and so on. All useful, all good. We shouldn't be having, frankly, any discussions until there's a motion on the table that's been seconded. I think, again, I've already said that I'm not prepared, I'm as guilty as anybody else, I'm not prepared to discuss or adopt one of the four scenarios as a budget assumption. But given the heat, I think there ought to be a motion on the table of some sort. It sounds like, Rich, what you wanted was a discussion on whether we should adopt any of the four scenarios or a fifth scenario if we wanted to, as an assumption before we move forward, before any of this other discussion takes place. Then we can talk about it.
No, my comment was that we should have a meeting before we decide what we're going to, you know, to decide what we're going to, which is scenario we're going to go for. And that meeting should occur before the 29th of March, because that's when our first session is with the staff. So I think maybe this week or early next week, we should have a special meeting just to determine.
Well, to your point, Councilor Antipas, I mean, the item that we're discussing is the FYE 2018 budget.
That's true.
So I don't think that we need any kind of motion, and I don't have a discussion about any particular point. But I'm not, you know, I'm not the pro at these things. But I think that, you know, we're having a general discussion about the budget, and there's been some good points brought up. And I don't think we're doing, and I don't think we need a motion about a particular one to continue discussing it, but I certainly could stand corrected. So I think that I think to Rich's original point, though, Greg brought it up too, and is that the baseline that we start at has nothing to do with what we're going to cut or not cut. It's to understand where we stand at the end of the process. You know, what the mill rate would be. And so, because you have to have some kind of scenario in order to proceed, or else you'd have to line up all four scenarios and constantly try to figure out what it would be at each scenario. Mm-hmm. I think that's certainly possibly an option, but it sounds like a pretty complicated one. So it sounds like we should contemplate it. The people have stated they're not ready to state which option they'd like to do, if any at all. But it's certainly food for thought.
Can I make a suggestion that we modify the agenda for the special meeting on Thursday and add this to that after that issue that we're already talking about on Thursday?
Will people be ready by Thursday to have a discussion? No? Yes? Karen, you look concerned? Yes? All right.
Mr. Mayor, if I might, the reason why I brought this up, I'm not being unnecessarily a stickler, is because this is a very important topic for people. People want to know, and obviously some of us are very upfront about reassuring taxpayers where they're coming from. And I purposely confine my remarks to the issue of which scenario, if any, we should adopt. And I'm not a stranger to being accused of something.
because I kept my peace, because I thought it wasn't time to speak. And so I just want to disabuse people of the notion that because I have not come out and said, well, I'm for the taxpayer, and I'm for no increase, and shame on the Board of Ed and all of that, that I don't share the opinions. I simply did not make those remarks, as I thought we were talking about the scenarios, not the overall temperature in the room and what we feel about the budget, so. And again, it's not in a vacuum. I've done this before where I've kept my mouth shut, and people have said, oh, he's one of those. So.
Okay, anybody else? So Mark, is it too late to add it?
Quick question, do we still have the two police chiefs in the dispatch center on next week's agenda? Are we going to have them on so we can get information for merging?
I'm going to say no.
Because we're going to need the cost for that.
Thank you for bringing that up.
Yeah, I want to move forward with that, thank you.
Did we give the impression that it was going to be on the agenda?
I thought she brought it up at the last meeting, and I understood that it was, you had asked Mark about putting it on for the 28th.
It was a promise.
Promise.
It was.
All right, I'll go take a look, I'll let you know.
Okay.
All right. So Mark, we still have time to change the agenda for Thursday?
Yes, we do.
Okay. All right. We'll close that item out, and it is 7:30, I think, 7:28, so we'll wait 2 minutes. Mark?
We have two items left on, I think you have two options. And I have no idea how long this joint meeting is going to last, so you could simply recess until after. Or if you wanted to, we could take these two items and just tack them onto Thursday's special meeting agenda. One is appointing three folks to serve on the committee of three and three for the city highway. The other is the discussion of, is there any interest in the former police barracks building on Thames? I mean, probably both a two-minute discussion, but if you wanted to put it on Thursday.
That's fine.
So put it on Thursday.
Sure.
Is the attorney here for that reason?
So that moves us to, we can finish out this meeting, correct, and then move on to the.
I make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Oh.
Is there any other business? All right, we have a motion to adjourn, we are so adjourned.